Hello, I'm Leah Gardner. How are you today, Eddie?
I'm fair. How are you?
I'm good, sir. Well, today we're going to be talking about how disabled people get tangled up in the World Wide Web. And we're going to have a special guest on the phone from Washington, D.C. named Justin Thorpe to speak about that with us. And we're also going to answer your questions, too. So if you've gotten tangled up in the web, give us a call at 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. Before we begin, however, on our last program, we profiled a gentleman from Santa Rosa named Rob Torres, and this show generated a tremendous amount of response. And due to this, we want to start today's program with an essay that he wrote. So take it away, Robert.
As some of you out there might know, I have a laundry list of medical problems in my life and have been hospitalized for both medical and mental reasons. But those are just nice little segues for what I'm about to talk about. Hospitals. I'm sure most of you think of a large white building with doctors in coats walking to and fro, taking people's temperatures and making sick people well again. Personally, the first thing to come to my mind is a building with doctors who see you as paychecks and only want to keep you quiet with drugs that slowly take their toll on your body. Sounds unreal, huh? Well, it's all true. Mental health has fallen to the wayside for the last 40 years, and anyone who has had to bear through the almost non-existent help will tell you the same. Having been in the mental health system for a large portion of my life, I've seen the multitude of holes and faults that all too many unfortunate souls have fallen through. After a great deal of research, I think I've discovered where this problem came from. Ronald Reagan, a popular actor gone governmental. Many people think he was a great president. The far greater who have not lived such a charmed life would know exactly what he did, all for the sake of money. During the Reagan administration, the Cold War had put a drain upon the American economy, and being the caring person he was, Ronald Reagan slashed the funding of the government-run mental hospitals, sending most of their patients who needed help on the street with nobody to help them, dooming them to a life of vagrancy. Mental hospitals were little more than prisons for the criminally insane at this time. Now, Reagan promised that when the war was over, he would put all that money into privately owned hospitals. But of course, he was lying through his teeth and simply went right back to sleep after his term was up. 48 years later, I can think of no government-funded mental hospitals. And the only hospital I know of that had the heart to treat people that they knew couldn't pay is going under. What strikes me as odd is that nobody has even bothered to remedy this situation in the least. Even through the huge surplus we had during the Clinton administration, even in 2002, the U.S. government had the money to hand out $300 checks to anyone who made the requisite amount of money, a gimmick to help stimulate the economy, which was obviously a bonehead move because $300 doesn't help any singular person. But that money pooled could have started back up those hospitals and helped countless people get back on the road to a healthy and normal life. But unfortunately, things can't be that easy. Taking a step away from what has happened, I'll now give you a glimpse of what is happening. For those of you who are lucky enough to have never been inside a mental hospital, I'll give you a list of the different therapies they tend to use in hospitals. Number one, medication. And that's about it. Now, it's not that I hate medication. Well, that's not exactly true. But I do recognize that medication and therapy can be great for treatment. But when the medication becomes the treatment, that's when you need to step back and reevaluate things. It's simple to call someone fixed when they don't complain anymore. It's even simpler still to get this illusion of help from a pill that numbs the patient out. So, now, here's the question. Why rock the boat? If you can make someone seem well, what makes it any different from actually being well? The answer is simple. Because it's wrong! Researching further, the best form of treatment is done with a combination of diet, art therapy, music therapy, talk therapy, group therapy, and, on occasion, medication as well. You might be asking yourself, if this really is the best form of treatment, why doesn't every hospital adopt this method? Now, if I knew the root answer to this question, maybe I could do something about it. Heck, maybe we could all do something about it. But this problem, like many, gets the default answer of cost too much money. Now, perhaps it does, but a new day is rising. This recession won't last forever, and when it's over and the surplus has returned, what excuse can be given then? I personally think that the time for caring for people that can already care for themselves is well over, and I'm more sure than ever that many more people out there feel the same way that I do. Until the day that the care gets put back into mental health care, the best support you can find now is friends and family. I know that's what got me well again. Well, for now, I'll leave you with the immortal words of Jerry Springer. Take care of yourselves and each other. Until next time, this is Robert, bringing words of clarity to a world of hallucinations.
Thanks for the piece, Robert. We appreciate it. Well, speaking of clarity, Eddie, I have to tell you, I am really incredibly annoyed about something.
About what?
Well, we're going to talk about web accessibility today, and let me give you the human side of this in my life. You know, some of you know that I've done some performance poetry work in my life, and I've actually been dealing with a website called famecast.com of late, and I've been having some tremendous difficulties with this website as a totally blind person. It is probably one of the most inaccessible sites I have ever dealt with. Just to sign up to be part of this contest that they're running to put up a video on their website, I actually had to try and decipher these characters on the screen that are in a picture. Now, can I see a picture, Eddie?
Can you see a picture?
With my eyesight, can I see a picture?
No, you can't see a picture.
So, you know, it's very difficult to try to interpret these skewed characters and write them down. And, you know, the funny thing about this is in trying to do that, the message on the screen said, if you can't see this, you know, click here and it will refresh the image. Now, for totally blind people, that's kind of a problem. I've also had other issues with different flash media on this website. Every time I bring it up, all these different pictures and sounds come up and the page keeps refreshing. So, as you can tell, I'm a little bit annoyed. So, it spurred some conversation that resulted in today's problem that we're going to be talking about. The World Wide Web. It's been around for quite a while. It's made some lives easier. It's probably made some lives difficult. But it's a big tangle of technology, and we're going to be talking about it today with our guest, Justin Thorpe. He's a web developer and consultant with the government contractor, CACI International. Welcome to the show, Justin.
How you doing?
Good.
Hey, Justin. Hi, this is Eddie, along with Leo. We're on Pushing Limits.
Great to be here.
And let me remind you before we continue that if you want to talk about how disability impacts your interaction with the World Wide Web, you can reach us at 510-848-4425.
So, Justin, the Internet gets to be more and more inclusive in our lives. We're constantly using it. It's also real helpful. We could pay bills. We could research papers or articles. We could do grocery shopping. We could even basically do our paid work at home now using the Internet. However, at the same time, more and more issues have come up having to do with access for people with disabilities. Is there any way that people with disabilities can avoid using the Internet these days, you know, even considering all the issues that we're having?
I think it would be really hard to. As you said, as the Internet grows, it's quickly becoming more and more a part of our lives where there are more and more services where people are taking that have typically been part of a brick-and-mortar a physical type of experience and moving it online because it's cheaper and easier to reach more people. And in some instances, it can even be more accessible. When you think about people who have vision disabilities or problems reading print, I have a good friend of mine who has a real problem reading books or one of my roommates in college. You would see him, studying for his tests and, you would see him with his face like an inch away from the book, and I'm like, Derek, what are you doing? But he told me he had a really hard time seeing the book. But then we went to his computer, and I showed him how he could turn the font size up in his browser and how that really transformed his experience. And really, it's not an experience he was able to get in print, but it was able to get on the web. So I think, as I said, it's going to be an ever more inclusive part of our lives. But also, I think in some instances, it can actually give you a better experience than the physical experience.
You know, it's interesting because I do know a lot of people complain about the internet and they don't really want to use it. And I remember when I was in junior high, probably about 17, 18 years ago, I had a teacher say, you know, in about 20 years, we're going to be able to shop on the computer. And to everybody in the class, it was this extraordinary claim that she was making. And it has come to fruition. And it seems to me that we're at a time and place where there has been more change over the past 20 years than there has been in just a very, very, very long time. And what do you say to people that maybe aren't ready to catch up? How is it going to improve their lives? Because there are a lot of people that are fighting this change.
Good question. I think, as a developer, as someone who creates these type of products and user experiences, you absolutely have to keep those people in mind, you know, and really from the beginning, you know, really think out who are all the different users, and there are going to be plenty of users who are going to be using my product or using my website who may not be as gung-ho or as excited about trying to use it. So making it as friendly or making the experience as welcoming as possible for everyone is so essential, and it's so something that everyone needs to understand.
All right, we're going to take our first call. Ray from San Francisco, welcome to Pushing Limits.
Hi, you might call this a kind of a call that was occasioned by something we heard you say a little while ago about people who are blind. Maybe it's a call to see if this is an issue. The question is that as of the 18th of September, I believe, or thereabouts, the middle of September, the phone company suspended its universal carriage of the time signal, which would be delivered with a beep every 10 seconds by calling POP 1111. You could get the time. Now you can't do that anymore. The only way you can get the times by calling the Institute of Standards in Colorado, or if you happen to know some other number. And otherwise, the phone company says simply, well, we think enough people know what time it is already. They don't need this service, and we want to free up these numbers.
You know what, Ray? We're actually talking about the Internet specifically on the show today, and I think...
That's why I wanted to bring this question up.
Because okay, go ahead.
The case is being made that people can get the time off the Internet. But if you can't see and you can't use the Internet to get the time, or maybe there is a service on the Internet that delivers the audio equivalent of a time signal rather than a visual. Well, I mean, is this a hardship for people who can't see? Is it difficult to get the correct time signal? And is the phone company making themselves that much easier to kick around by taking a segment of the disabled community and simply saying, hey, you don't need us and we don't need you?
Let me turn this question around a little bit. Thanks for the call, Ray. Justin, I think what this basically the caller is getting at is that, again, you know, the times are definitely changing and more phone services that used to be available are not. I think the companies are finding that they're not useful anymore to a wide segment of society. And I mean, do you have any comments about his call? Because I think that's what it alludes to.
My father always told me never to assume anything. And a lot of times I think businesses make assumptions about who their users are without actually understanding it. A lot of times you hear statistics and you may think, oh, my website or my service may not have people with disabilities who are using it. And a lot of times it's just not true. I was speaking to a group of people about web accessibility a few months ago, and I asked, are any of the people in the room colorblind? And we had three or four hands shoot up out of a group of 30. And colorblindness isn't the type of thing where it's not blatantly obvious that someone has that type of disability. I have one friend who has no sense of smell, but, I mean, it's another thing you wouldn't know. I don't think you can assume about your users what who they are and what types of disabilities that they may or may not have. So really making a website that everyone can use regardless of the environment or the circumstances or the context of how they're using it, I think is key. And following kind of industry best practices and industry guidelines is the way to do that. Forget what else I was going to say. But, yeah.
All right. I think generally speaking, though, that the use of the Internet has, you know, just great influences on other parts of our lives. There's less live telephone usage. Everything is automated. And I think that kind of goes back to us as a society just relying more and more on the Internet and computers than on things in the past, technologies in the past like telephones. And one of my concerns, however, is that for people with disabilities, especially for those of us that are lower income, are we going to be left out? Are we going to be losing things because of the new technologies are going to require, it's going to require more expenses on our part? And will some of us just not be able to afford the new technologies and therefore not be able to use some of the features on the Internet, Justin?
One of the kind of the common themes that you hear a lot of kind of people who talk about web development talk about is something called progressive enhancement. So what does that mean? That means as you add some of the more newer features, whether it be specific styling or special interactivity, that you add them in layers so that you add them, you have the core experience, you know, you have the content in a way that everyone can read it, but then you layer the newer kind of technologies on top of the core experience so that if you have an older machine or you have equipment that wouldn't allow you to, or a disability that wouldn't allow you to see that more, that enhanced interactive experience, that you'd be able to kind of peel off those extra layers and still be able to experience the content the same way that everybody else would.
So if you're using, you know, Windows 98 today, which is an operating system that probably a lot of people who have gotten used computers are using, are you still going to be able to function on the Internet now?
You should be able to. I mean, and the exciting thing, at least with a lot of the developers that I hang out with, is that web accessibility and really thinking it from the start is starting to become a way of thinking. I mean, that if it's you're not considered a professional in the web industry unless your web accessibility is a part of the way that you do things. So it's exciting. I mean, we still have a lot of education to do and a lot of training to do and a lot of evangelism to do, but I think it's really coming along. Was speaking with one of the Flash developers that I work with today, I spoke with him today, and one big part of the way that he does it is so that even if you don't have Flash, or you don't want to use Flash, there's still some type of equivalent experience that gives you the same content regardless of whether you have Flash enabled or not, which is really exciting. Because, you know, Flash is a plugin, and so some people may not have it, or some people may be really annoyed by Flash. I know there are plenty of experiences of Flash where I really don't enjoy seeing it on the page. And, you know, some people just may not use it, but then giving them that same experience. And it's really not that hard. There are a lot of accessibility features built into these new technologies that people aren't aware of but could start taking advantage of if they were educated as such.
Craig, welcome to Pushing Limits.
Hi. I've got two questions actually. One is just a very basic one. I believe you were the one that was earlier on. You were talking, if I'm not mistaken, it was you. Was talking about how certain websites were just giving you fits as a visually impaired person.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sitting there waiting for you to explain how it is that a blind person even uses such a technology that is so, you know, visually, the visual component is so dominant. I have some awareness that there are, I guess, is software that will convert text and you get it reads it to you basically audibly.
Really?
But at least I've heard of such things. I don't know if those are really in use or not. But if it would be nice if you would explain how you as a blind person actually are able to use a computer screen.
Sure, thanks. Thanks for the call.
I do have another question for you, and this is more for your guest. My son actually does a lot of this kind of stuff. He maintains a website and does programming for a bank, And it's never occurred to me to ask him if he takes into account the fact that there are visually impaired people who need to use that interface. I'm just, you know, be curious anything your guest has to say about that sort of situation.
Okay, thanks for the call, Craig. Just a real quick snapshot. There are a couple products available that actually present what is on the screen in an audible form. So basically, I can hear whatever's presented on the screen through a voice. It's basically speech software. It's called screen reader software. So it's announcing to me what's on the screen and what's coming up on it. But this actually leads me to one of the questions that I wanted to discuss with you. And as a visually impaired person, and I'm sure there are other people in our audience, too, that just have fits with this, CAPTCHAs. One of the things our screen reading software does not deal with are CAPTCHAs. Can you explain for our audience what a CAPTCHA is, why it's used, and why this might be difficult for somebody that can't see?
Absolutely. And they're difficult for people that can't see, well, too. I hate them dearly. A CAPTCHA, a lot of times on the web, you'll see registration forums or places where you can comment on blogs. A lot of times places where, any place where a user can, edit, comments or edit or input their own personal information into a page, you'll see these little images with all these kind of jangled up text. And what happened, was that, programmers figured out ways where they could send spiders or kind of their own little pieces of software to enter in fake information into those forms in order to try to gain some benefit out of it. You know, if I'm a registration system, I want to get all of the accounts under a certain system. So I want to take all of the Yahoo accounts for a certain set of names or something like that. So computer, other sets of computer programmers, and I originally think CAPTCHA was started by a group out of Carnegie Mellon. They designed a system called CAPTCHA, and I forget what the acronym stands for, but they wanted to test to see, is this person who's filling out this form, are they a human or are they a computer? And so they made this little image, and they figured, at the time that they could test to see if a person was a human by saying, can you read this image, or can you read the kind of mangled letters that are in this image, and then retype them into a little box underneath the image? Now, you know, typically, according to best practice for creating a website, when you put an image online, you would put some type of alternative text inside of the HTML, which would say what the image is. Well, for a CAPTCHA, that kind of blows the whole point of what it's there to do. You wanna see if the person's a computer or a human, but you don't want to make it easy for the computer to be able to get what the image is. So typically, or usually, there's no alternative text on the image. So this makes it incredibly hard for visually impaired users to be able to use these registration forms, because there's really no way for them to tell what is in the image. You started to see some over the web. You start to see new ways of making this more accessible. Some work better than others. Usually a lot to different success. Sometimes you'll see sound alternatives where a user can click the little button and then they'll hear a sound. Usually my experience has been when I've played around with those, the sound isn't usually that good. So you'll hear, click the little button, it'll say, you know, CA369B or something, and then you have to remember that and then type that back in. I've also seen plenty of little kind of tests where they'll say, please retype the word social, or what is 5 plus 5, and then you would type in 10. And then that's a way that you can not have to use CAPTCHA. Another method is to use these spam tracking systems. For blogging, I use a program called WordPress, and a product that they made. The people who make WordPress also made this product called Akismet, where it'll analyze spam and tell you what is or what is not spam. And they've studied millions of pieces of spam comments on blogs. So they really have a good idea of what is and what isn't spam. And so they can analyze a comment on a blog and tell you if it's spam or not. And it's really successful. I've gone from getting hundreds of emails a day, which are comments to my blog, which are just spam, to one or two a week, which makes it so that I don't need to use CAPTCHA on my blog and make that barrier. It makes it so there are no barriers for somebody who would want to comment on my blog, which is really exciting.
Wonderful. So there are absolutely, for web designers, there are ways around the CAPTCHA. And so there's a tip for for Craig's son right there. There are ways around the CAPTCHAs. CAPTCHAs are probably one of the most inaccessible new web technologies out there.
One of the resources I would point people to is the W3C, the World Wide Web Consortium Web Accessibility Initiative, put together a resource talking about CAPTCHAs and what they are, kind of the history of them, but then also, what are the alternatives, and if people don't want to use CAPTCHA, what are the options for what they can do? So.
Great. Okay, really quick.
Yeah, I want to pick up on one question, though, that was brought up earlier about the ability of businesses to have their websites accessible, like banks was one example. Currently, a federal judge has granted class action status to a lawsuit alleging that Target is inaccessible and breaking the ADA because it's not accessible to blind people. And Justin Thorpe, I was wondering, do you have a good sense as to whether businesses are starting to get pretty good about having their websites accessible to blind and other people with other kinds of disabilities?
It really depends. I know a lot of kind of more small developer shops, small groups or small businesses where their sole job is to develop websites. A lot of those have become really good at making websites the right way and making them accessible. But a lot of times when you have these really complicated content management systems or really complicated pieces of software, chances are that they haven't been architected in a way that that produce an accessible website. So that's a lot of kind of what the education and evangelism outreach is going towards now, is let's make sure that not just the small websites, the small businesses, the developers, the small kind of consulting shops make their websites the right way, but that everyone does, so we can go after the bigger websites as well. So it just takes time. I think it's getting better and better. And I think the case with the National Federation for the Blind and Target, I think, all of this is setting pretty important precedent, or will set pretty important precedent. And it's interesting to watch. And I think a lot of people who make websites and a lot of people who work at big corporations who are responsible for websites are standing up and taking notice to see what will happen and starting to see that
Absolutely. Justin, that's a great note to end the program. And unfortunately, we're sorry to the caller on the line. We've got to go. Thanks so much for listening to Pushing Limits. And it's been a very instructive day. I want to thank Jan Santis and Doyle Saylor for production help, as well as Adrian Lobby, Rob Torres for the essay. Thanks to my co-host, Eddie Duarte. And thank you so much, Justin Thorpe, for joining us. It was a pleasure.
Cause I've got my strength, and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, keep on pushing. Now maybe someday, keep on reach that high you go. I know I can make it with just a little bit of soul. Cause I've got my strength, and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing. Now look,
Education Today presents a radio town hall this Saturday, October 6th, from 10 to 12. Most of us have heard a bit about No Child Left Behind, the law that's supposed to be helping American children, but there are many critics, and the question we want to ask this Saturday is, do progressives have an alternative? So you'll be hearing critics of No Child Left Behind, those who defend it, and those who have a progressive alternative to present. Then you'll have a chance to weigh in also with your calls to KPFA. Again, a radio town hall on education issues this Saturday, October 6th from 10 to 12.